you are the dealer, I'm out of the game. If you are the healer, means I'm broken and lame. If thine is the glory, then mine must be the shame. You want it darker, we killed the
Freddy vs. Ash, the fan novel by A.S. Eggleston. Chapter 7. Sitting near the parking lot just outside of S-Mart, Cooper and Evelyn had just finished their shift and were laughing. After the spectacle they had just witnessed, they had a lot to laugh about. At least Cooper did, anyway. Really, it was just good to be alone for a while, to be someplace quiet, someplace to get away from the crowd. All of the gasps and murmurs. They sat on concrete steps. Cooper had his arm wrapped around her shoulder. They exchanged pleasant conversation and joked about what they saw earlier. Evelyn smirked as Cooper made fun of Ash falling asleep and tumbling over.
"I mean, I feel bad for him and everything, but he's kind of weird, you know?" Cooper said.
Evelyn caught her breath, chuckled passively, but looked away the whole time. She did feel bad for Ash. She didn't know what was going on with him. She figured he had a serious problem in his life, or he was just a major klutz. Evelyn rolled up the sleeves of her thermal green sweater until they were at an elbow length.
"That's not a nice thing to say about someone you don't know, Cooper," she said, criticizing him. "And no, I don't think he's weird," she said. "I just think maybe there's something wrong with him."
Cooper sat up a little straighter and smirked a little bit. He squinted his eyes at the glare of the sunset.
"What, like he's mental or something?" he joked.
"You know, that's what I really love about you, Evelyn. You never say anything bad about anybody, do you?" he said, not questioning, but assuming. "You're just always really, really nice to everybody." He admired Evelyn and how kind and sweet she was to everyone, even when it came to goofs like Ash. She always tried to see the good in them. She turned and looked at him in the eye.
"You know that's not true. Well, now that I think about it, yeah, I guess it is," she said with a timid smile. "It's just that,"
she prepared, searching for the right words.
"It seems like he's got problems. Maybe his home life isn't that great.
I know what that's like. I mean, you understand, right?
He nodded in agreement.
Yeah, I understand. You had it pretty bad with your dad way back when, he said. He turned to hug her tightly. But you live with me now. Well, you live across the hall from me now. Same difference.
Evelyn looked up at him, smiling and holding him. Cooper looked into her eyes and grinned.
Don't look at me with that tone of voice.
Stop judging me with your face. Cooper laughed and continued hugging her. Evelyn looked at the concrete below her. What they had just talked about had brought back some painful memories. Her home life was unsatisfying, to say the least. Having to grow up with an alcoholic father was difficult for Evelyn. It would have been difficult for any little kid. She was terrified of her own dad. The only thing she could do then was hide. Nightly, she would cower in her room, listening at her bedroom door, hearing her dad's drunken, heavy feet stagger around the house. Those bellowing footsteps would usually precede the vehement, angry shouting, always at her mother. Most of the time to her, it just sounded like incoherent yelling, like he was shouting just to frighten everyone. But sometimes, she could make out a few words. It was always something profane. Funny how the only words I could hear clearly from him were the ones with four letters. Her mom didn't really do much, at least not to Evelyn's knowledge. The only thing she would hear her do was to try to stay out of his way and remain calm even when she couldn't escape him. Not all the time, but every once in a while, during the nights when he would terrorize Evelyn's mom, she would be furious right back at him. Right after that, Evelyn would hear him punch her mom, following a great thudding noise. She always assumed that her mother had fell to the ground. Evelyn would lay there by the door, sobbing quietly for her dear mother, and stare at her bedroom window, fantasizing what it would be like to just pack everything up and run away. She was just 9 years old at that time. One night, things became really bad. The screams had gotten more boisterous, the smacks became louder, and the words had become more hurtful. She was afraid that if she didn't do anything, something horrible might happen to her mom. Evelyn got up the courage to race out of her room and into the living room and yell at her dad. Leave Mommy alone!
She saw him turn around and look at her with those cloudy, soulless eyes. And that grimaced face. He grabbed the back of her tiny head and hit her face against the wall. She fell right onto the floor. She immediately felt her nose throbbing. And when she felt it run, she touched it and looked. A single streak of blood dripped from her nose. Little Evelyn immediately ran back to her room as fast as she could. As soon as she graduated from Springwood High, she moved out on her own and made a living for herself. There weren't a lot of options for a girl who was fresh out of high school, so the only thing she could find was some low-paying job at S-Mart. She met Cooper there, which somehow made the drudgery of working day after day as a checkout girl a little bit easier. She loved him, and even though he was a wonderful boyfriend who promised to protect her at all costs, she knew that if a time ever came where she was alone, she knew how to protect herself. The memory of that night ran over and over again, like it was on a loop. What finally broke the cycle was when she heard the sound of Cooper's voice.
Hey, there's a party over at Stevens tonight. You want to go? He asked.
She jolted slightly and turned her head around. Heavily distracted, she wasn't sure what he said at first. She was off into her own little world for a second.
Sorry, she said. I was daydreaming. She pondered.
She wasn't really in the partying mood. It was a Wednesday, after all. Who has parties on a weekday? She never started asking herself that question until she got a job. But maybe she needed to have fun for once and go out.
Yeah, you know what? Okay, she agreed.
Cooper beamed. Yeah! Before he left, he leaned over and gave her a kiss. He asked, Will you rub my hair real quick? Evelyn rolled her eyes and ran her fingers through his hair for the second time that day. She smiled as he looked up at her.
You spoil me, he said.
Yep, she agreed without a second thought. Like a cat.
Cooper got off the concrete step, standing up straight.
Okay, I'll go warm up the car.
He gave her another kiss and walked off over to the end of the lot where his car was. Evelyn stood up and prepared to trail behind him, when, out of the corner of her eye, she saw Ash not far from her, throwing yet another can in the trash. She stopped and turned around halfway. Ash was heading to his Oldsmobile, getting ready to leave. He seemed like a decent guy, but lately he appeared really upset and agitated.
Evelyn wanted to at least find out what was wrong with him. She quickly walked over towards him. He had opened the door and was about to get in. Evelyn waved her hand over to him. Ash, she called. Do you have a minute?
Gee, let me think. No.
It was already sundown. Soon it would be dark. Ash needed to get out soon before any deadites started to show up in town. He saw her walking over to him. He thought he'd be quick enough to get in, slam the door, and pretend he didn't hear a word she said. But he had already made eye contact. Damn it, he muttered under his breath. He didn't want to be a jerk, but if he didn't leave soon, something bad might happen. Ash kept his right leg inside the car.
I really don't have a lot of time.
I just wanted to say sorry, she blurted, rushing the words from her mouth. About what happened today. She still kept a sympathetic smile. We should have helped you or done something, but we didn't. We just stood there, and I'm sorry about that. He started to become anxious, like every second that went by might as well have been an hour. He began ducking into his car.
Yeah, kid. Don't worry about it.
Evelyn stepped up closer so that the only thing between the two of them was the car door. Is something wrong? She asked before he sat down on the seat. You seem very nervous about something. She looked past Ash and grazed her eye over to the inside of his car. She saw what looked like a bunch of stuff covered by a dirty white sheet. What she didn't know was that stuff was his chainsaw and double-barreled shotgun, among other weapons and various dried-up bloodstains in the back of his car. Ash noticed her peeking around, shifting her body away from him slightly. He mimicked her movement, blocking her view. He chuckled nervously and said,
"Listen, kid."
"Evelyn," she interrupted. "My name is Evelyn."
"Evelyn," he repeated. "What you need to do is stop looking around in other people's stuff, and what I need to do is to get the hell out of here. Capiche?"
She was aghast for a moment. She was only trying to show some sympathy and be nice, and he just told her to scram. "Ash, I was just trying to be nice," she said. Ash realized he wasn't going to get rid of her easily. He thought maybe he should have just slammed the door and kept driving when he had the chance. Being polite obviously wasn't getting him anywhere. Maybe he should try another way.
"Yeah, well, you need to scram, Evelyn."
As the minutes went by, they bickered at each other. Ash was losing daylight, literally. He didn't know what to do at this point, so he just kept shouting, hoping Evelyn would lose hope and walk away. After some trial and error, Cooper finally got his car started. He drove a black 1987 El Camino, and as the years went by, it took more and more attempts just to start the damn thing. After the fifth try, he had become a little irritated, his keys clinking with his many keychains. One of them was a logo from the band Slayer, red letters in front of a flaming pentagram. He kept the inside looking good, at least. He thought it was. The tint on the windows had peeled off, making it look like a bad window cling. On the other dash, there was an Iron Maiden Eddie bobblehead in the far corner, shaking his angry, leathery face at him. He got out and looked around for Evelyn. He could hear voices coming from the other end of the lot. Looking across the way, he saw Ash yelling at her about something. Immediately, he ran over to find out what was wrong, and beat the snot out of that Ash guy if need be.
Hail to the king, baby.
Chapter 8. From across the parking lot, Cooper could see Evelyn and Ash bickering at each other. He couldn't make out any specific words, but he could see the tension on Evelyn's face, and the way Ash was pointing at her. It looked like he was blaming her for something. As he walked towards them, he could hear their voices more clearly. The angrier he heard Ash get, the faster he moved. He couldn't help thinking that he must have done something to upset her. Did he say something that offended her? Did he make another pass at her, and she finally had enough? Of course, with Ash, it was probably something weird and out of the blue. The question he focused on the most was how was he going to deal with him. When Cooper caught up with them, he gently moved Evelyn away from Ash, allowing him to stand between them. "What's going on here?" he asked, leering at Ash. Cooper hunched over to look her in the eyes, keeping his hands on her shoulders. "Evelyn, did he say something to you?" he asked her.
It all hit her at once. The yelling, the shouting, the arguing. Why was she putting herself through this? She wondered why she didn't just walk away and leave him alone. Why did she just involve herself in some big scene like that? She felt so embarrassed that she couldn't talk for a moment. She tried to justify herself. She became frustrated and tried to calm herself down. He started yelling at me, and I don't know, I guess I... Cooper cut her off and whipped the other way around so that he faced Ash. "Have I not made it clear during the past week that I don't want you bothering her?" he said. Ash remained calm, irritated but calm. He looked at Cooper with resentment in his eyes. "All right, I've had it up to here with your bullshit. Both of you." He pointed at Evelyn. He stood up straight, looking down at Ash. Cooper squinted his eyes and turned his head to the side inquisitively. "What the fuck is your problem? You don't talk to my girlfriend like that," he said. Evelyn grabbed him by the arm and pulled him down so that she could speak in his ear. She was already furious. She didn't want to get Cooper involved. "Cooper, stop it. I can deal with this myself," she said curtly. "No," he said. He turned back to Ash. "I want to know why this guy's always such a flake." He stepped closer to Ash. As he was talking, he noticed him turn away a little bit. His nostrils were still flared and his eyebrows were still cocked, but Ash looked defensive. Cooper played on it. "Yeah," he said. "You know what I'm talking about, don't you?" he interrogated. "You always look like you're trying to hide something." Evelyn paused for a moment to think about that. She had mentioned how Ash always seemed nervous for some reason. Was he keeping some kind of secret? She thought maybe Cooper was actually onto something. She looked at Ash and saw how nervous he looked. Even though he tried to hide it, he wasn't very good at it. She continued listening to Cooper. "The constant coffee runs, the twitching, the spazzing. Do you stay out all night?" he asked. He smirked and jutted his face in front of Ash. "What? Did you kill someone?" Ash averted his eyes the other way, looking guilty. "It's more like hundreds, really," he thought. Cooper's face dropped. Suddenly his smirky demeanor turned more serious. He stepped closer towards him. "Wait, did you?" he asked. He said, "Dude." Ash cut him off right then. He poked him on the chest with his index finger. "I'm not your dude," he said sternly. "Okay, sorry." Cooper looked at his metal hand, which was placed on the roof of his Oldsmobile. "Is that how you got the RoboCop hand?" Turned back to Evelyn. "I knew it, Evelyn. I told you this guy was weird," he said, cocking his thumb at Ash behind him. Ash blew up with anger. Ash jerked his head up and stared straight at him. He pointed at him with his metal hand, threatening him. "All right, buddy, listen. You little pipsqueak," he barked. Cooper intruded. "What are you going to do about it, asshole?" he dared. Although in Cooper's position, that wasn't a very bright thing to say. For all he knew, he could actually kill him right then and there. For a quick second, Ash glanced up above the top of Cooper's head and saw the sunset slowly receding into the horizon ahead of him. It was going to get dark soon. Very soon. In fact, if he didn't leave right that very moment, all hell would break loose. Literally. He had to think quick. So he directed his attention back to Cooper and said, "I don't have time for this. I gotta get out of here. Now," he said, more to himself than to Cooper. He pushed him away, got in his car, slammed the door, and sped away. Cooper and Evelyn listened to the sound of the tires squeal and watched the red tail lights fade into the distance.
Shop smart, shop S-Mart.
They had just barely made it to the street corner before the engine in Cooper's El Camino started to sputter, and the stereo began to go on and off. He put it in park and proceeded to bang on the dashboard. "Oh, come on, why?" he said, hoping they wouldn't have to drive back home in silence. "This piece of shit's always got something wrong with it." Evelyn had freed herself from the seatbelt, but still slumped in the cushions, watching Cooper hit the dash with the bottom of his palm. She knew why he so desperately wanted to fill the silence. She was really pissed at Cooper for interrogating Ash just a few hours ago. What he had said to him would have gotten Cooper a square punch in the face.
She guessed he must have just been lucky. The party was being held at Stephen's house. Well, technically his parents' house, but his parents were out of town, so all bets were off. It was a pretty nice house, too. Stephen Gordon and his sister Jill lived in one of the more posh neighborhoods in Springwood. Of course, every neighborhood seems picturesque when compared to the crummy apartment building that Cooper and Evelyn lived in. The house was two stories, painted olive green on the exterior. It had a garage and square windows, one by the door and three on the second story. From the windows, you could see strobe lights and high school kids passing by. The front door was off to the side, guided by a trail of various shrubbery and flowers. They had parked about a block away from the house. The rest of the street was lined with cars and high school kids. Cooper leaned back in his seat and turned to Evelyn. "Never mind," he said. "There's no point. You ready?" he asked. Evelyn still stared at him with detest in her eyes. "Yeah," she said passively. "I guess so." She pushed the clunky metal door open and stepped out. Evelyn slammed the door with a little more vigor than Cooper, which didn't settle well with him. It sounded like she was trying to shatter the windows. He flinched his eyes at the mere thought of it. "I take it you're still mad at me?" he said, still flinching. Evelyn put her hands on the roof of his car. "Yes, I'm still mad about what happened." Cooper looked at the floor in shame. "I am so sorry, baby," he said. "Please don't be mad." He raced over to the other side to meet with her. He took her hand in his. "I'm really sorry. I didn't mean to be disrespectful to you. It's just that if I see someone getting in your face like that, I flip the fuck out."
"I know you do, and I appreciate it, but I can handle things by myself, all right?" said Evelyn. "And it's not just you. I was mostly mad at Ash for acting like that. He just blew up for no reason."
She playfully smacked him on the back of the head. "But you made it worse by almost getting in a fight with him."
"Ow," said Cooper, rubbing his head. "Yeah, that's true, but I could have taken him. I'm like..." He put about half an inch of space between his index finger and thumb. "That much taller than him. So no wonder he left, because he was going to go down." Both of them laughed. Cooper put her palm on the side of his face. He pouted his lip like a sad puppy. He said in a baby voice, "Sawwee, do you forgive me?" Evelyn exhaled deeply. She gave him a half smile.
"Okay, you're forgiven this time."
"Yay," he said and hugged her.
"I love you."
"I love you too."
They released themselves from their hug and walked on the concrete walkway leading to the front door. They both had switched their S-Mart smocks for something more suited for a night out. Cooper had worn his gray and orange jacket. Evelyn wore a black Sabbath jersey with her freshly curled hair slightly covering the logo. By the time she reached the doorway, Cooper raced ahead of her to knock on the door. When he extended his arm to knock, the door had already flown open. Following was the sound of, "Hey, look who it is!" It was Stephen, flailing his arms up, with a game controller in his left hand. It was amazing he could tell who it was, since Stephen had dark emo hair covering most of his face. If it weren't for the bright red shirt and Converse sneakers, he could easily be mistaken for a run-of-the-mill goth kid. "Come in!" he yelled over the music. They edged themselves in, trying to avoid bumping into anybody. "Hi, Stephen," Evelyn said, her voice almost fading in with the music.
"Hey, man," Cooper yelled, nearly interrupting Evelyn. "What's up?"
Evelyn stood between them, cramped and uncomfortable. She was starting to regret coming here in the first place. Stephen stepped back and leaned over to Evelyn.
"Jill's in the kitchen. I'll get her for you."
He took a half step to the side, poked his head out to the kitchen and yelled, "Hey, Jill, Evelyn's here!" Well, geez, Evelyn thought, I could have done that. She edged herself away and stood by the hallway. A few seconds later, she saw a beam of blonde hair darting in and out of the crowd. Jill ran up to her and hugged her.
"Hey," she said over the music, "I'm glad you made it."
Jill stepped back and Evelyn noticed her Stars and Stripes t-shirt, which had a few holes in it, and the sleeves were cut off. Jill was pretty much the standard blonde-haired, blue-eyed, pretty girl in high school. She had just turned 18 a few months earlier, now making her 2 years older than her brother. After the kind of day she'd been through, Evelyn needed some interaction with sane people. Evelyn and Jill had known each other forever, well, ever since they were in high school, before she met Cooper. And it was nice for her to know that no matter how difficult it was on her own, she had Jill to let her know things will be okay. Stephen turned Cooper. holding his controller up by his head. "Coop," he said. "Do you hear it? Do you hear the call?" Steven asked. Cooper squinted his eyes at him. "What call?" he asked him back. Steven grinned and cocked his eyebrows. "The call of duty," he said. Cooper put his hands close to his face and rubbed them together. He laughed evilly. They both ran over to the living room and planted themselves on the couch, along with the rest of the gaming nerds. Cooper immediately picked up the controller that was laying on the coffee table and picked up where everyone else had left off. Jill nodded her head in disapproval. "Look at them, a bunch of five-year-olds." She turned to Evelyn, smiling. She led her into the kitchen. "Come on, girl, I got food." Evelyn and Jill walked over to the kitchen. The male adolescent screams and profanity slowly fading with each step. The kitchen was crowded with people, too, but it wasn't as bad. At least it was more quiet. They leaned back by the marble counter, watching the people zoom in and out. Jill grabbed a big bowl of chips and placed it between them. They each grabbed one and took a bite. "So, how are things?" Jill asked between bites. Evelyn looked at her derisively, mentally telling her that today had not been such a good day. "Pretty crappy," she began. "I mean, everything's fine now, but..." Evelyn grabbed another handful of chips. "I mean, I guess it was partly my fault. I kind of started the thing after work, but..." She said, her words muffled. "But what?" Jill inquired. Evelyn kept replaying the whole scene in her mind over again. The way Ash had been acting, how defensive he was about himself. His whole demeanor was strange, really. She kept trying to find a plausible explanation for it, but she just couldn't. It just made what Cooper said to him seem even weirder. Evelyn wasn't sure whether or not she wanted to show her face at work tomorrow and risk the chance of running into Ash again. "I can't explain it," she said. "It's just..." Before she could elaborate, their friend Faith Morey had walked in through the entryway and was now just a few feet from them. "Hi!" she yelled across the room, frantically waving her arm. Faith was a vision in 90s nostalgia. She wore a black tank top with a red flannel shirt tied around her waist, draping over her ripped-up jeans, which were rolled up just above her knee. She looked like she had just been to a Pearl Jam concert. Her hair was short and auburn, gently flowing against her pale skin. Her bangs just were above her eyes, making her look like her own anime character. She walked up to them and sat on top of the table in front of them. "Sup?" she asked casually. Evelyn copied her remark. "Sup?" she answered. "Pretty good, pretty good." Jill turned to her. "Faith, where have you been?" She looked around before answering, all the while smirking. "I may or may not have been out with your brother for the past hour." She cocked an eyebrow. "Doing what?" "Going to S-Mart, stealing one of their shopping carts, and then taking turns riding it down a hill." She turned to Evelyn. "It was fun." "I must have just missed you then," said Evelyn. "That was very strange, but I'm going to ignore that for now." Jill turned back to Evelyn. "So," she said, "you were saying?" Evelyn continued. "Oh, yeah." She paused for a moment, wondering how exactly to put it into words. "You remember that guy I work with?" she reminded them. "Big chin, kind of intense looking." "You mean that old guy?" Jill asked. "Yeah." "Oh, right," Faith remembered. "The guy with the, Faith raised her right hand and waved her fingers from left to right, mimicking Ash's semi-robotic hand. "Yeah, I know who you're talking about. What happened?" Evelyn recalled her experience. "I was standing by the register, and I heard this crash. I went over there, and it was Ash. He..." "Fucked up royally by the housewares department today," Cooper said to Steven and the rest of his buddies. He didn't turn to face them as he spoke, as he was too busy shooting bad guys and dodging snipers. Like a boss, he thought. Cooper jerked and twitched his body from side to side as if it was gonna somehow affect his playing. "What'd he do?" Steven asked as he took a drink of soda, his controller in the same hand. "He fell over a table and nearly got himself stabbed by a bunch of knives," he said, switching eye contact between Steven and everyone else. Cooper smirked. "I mean, it was terrible, but kind of funny." Sitting next to him was Kyle. He was lean with some stubble around his face and had short brown hair.
He was wearing an Avenged Sevenfold t-shirt, which had, over the course of the evening, accumulated food stains across it. He joined in the conversation.
"Dude, why do you hate him so much, really?" he asked.
Cooper continued to stare at the television screen. He scoffed.
"He's just such a
nice guy." "Well, most of the time he is," Evelyn answered her friend's question about Ash. "But today, when I wanted to see how he was doing, he was acting very strangely," she said.
"Strange how?" Jill asked.
"It was like he was in a hurry, you know? And he just acted really secretive," she elaborated. "And the more I asked about it, the angrier he got. Then Cooper got involved. They both started fighting, and it was just a big mess."
Neither Jill nor Faith really said anything for a while. They just nodded in passive sympathy.
"So," Faith said, "where do you think Mr. Big Chin Guy was in such a hurry to go anyway?"
She grabbed a can of Ready Whip and ate a palm-sized ball of whipped cream straight from the nozzle.
Evelyn stared at the ground for a while. She'd already been pondering that question for 2 hours now. If it didn't come to her then, she was sure the answer wasn't going to appear to her now. Evelyn simply shrugged.
Cooper lowered his elbows for the first time since he sat down to play the game. He rested the controller on his lap. Suddenly, the sounds of gunfire and thematic score, along with the overlapping conversations from the crowd and the techno music blaring from Steven's speakers, lulled in Cooper's ears. Everything just started to run together and fade away.
"Fucked if I know."
The twin headlights illuminated the pathway as Ash cruised around town hunting for demonic entities. He came across a long, stretched-out overpass, beside the moonlight, settling on the indigo sky above him. The bright yellow lights coming from his Delta 88 were the only sources of light detouring him. He traveled so far that he was pretty sure he was about to reach city limits. He hadn't seen a deadite for the past few miles. He considered just turning to another street and heading to another side of Springwood. Ash looked around him, appreciating the quiet isolation around him and the vast emptiness of deadites so far. He traveled along a concrete road on the outskirts of town, above a railway that had been abandoned for over 20 years. Rusted boxcars and railroad fragments covered the ground. It was past midnight, so there weren't any people around it either, hopefully, to fall prey to the deadites. He had felt this kind of isolation before, when he traveled to that cabin many years before, so Ash didn't feel so out of place here. On each side of the road, there was a barrier of metal railings that stood beside him, acting as a wall. Were they there to protect him, to keep him from the evil that lurks outside? Or were they there to seal him in and trap him? Ash decided not to revisit that thought and instead focused on the road ahead. It was the silence that calmed him. Ash never turned his radio on at night. If he did, he would likely become distracted and allow himself or someone else to be attacked. He had a feeling that tonight would be a slow night. At least he was hoping tonight would be a slow night. He hoped that the deadite population was slim to none by now. Ash had desperately wanted his run in Springwood to be over. He needed to be away from this town and the delusional madness that came with it. He prayed that it was just a delusion. As the years have gone by, Ash had upped his artillery than just his trusty chainsaw and shotgun. Tonight, he brought with him yet another shotgun, this one manufactured by Beretta. This particular one was a pump-action shotgun with a single 18-inch barrel and a matte black finish. He had also kept a 9mm pistol in his shoulder strap under his jacket. They were much sleeker than what he had been used to. Ash took his job seriously, which meant occasionally trading his bulky chainsaw for something more lightweight. His knuckles and his wrist grew numb from gripping the steering wheel for all that time. His back and neck became sore and his eyes began to flutter from the sheer monotony of it all. Ash readjusted himself and wriggled his fingers to loosen himself up. Just then, it was only faintly, but Ash heard a low growl. It came from his left. His ear twitched at the sound of it. It sounded feral, but at the same time, otherworldly. He looked outside the windshield to see a tall, slender deadite hiding near the gates beside the overpass. Even though it was dark outside, Ash's headlights permitted him to glance at his hideous facial features. The demon had a ripped and bloody t-shirt and jeans on. They were minor cuts. He'd probably gotten them from fighting off some other deadite who had infected the poor man. He had long, ratty black hair down to his elbows. The creases in his eyes were perversively deep and sunken, framing his dead, milky eyes. His jaw had elongated and hung open. Ash could see how his mouth had rotted from the inside out. His gums and tongue were black and slimy, while his teeth were yellow. His teeth were also large, misshapen, and stuck out in every direction, like a crocodile's. Ash slowed his car down to about 10 miles per hour. He quickly reached over to the passenger seat and grabbed his pump shotgun. He looked back to make sure the demon had not disappeared from view. He was still there, his gooey, salivating tongue sweeping side to side on the corners of his mouth, relishing the thought of eating Ash's soul, his pure and powerful soul. The undead menace sprinted towards Ash, with his right hand on the steering wheel and the left holding the shotgun outside the window. The dark-haired demon slayer pulled the trigger and blasted a hole in the deadite's head. Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 7 and 8 of Freddy vs. Ash by A.S. Eggleston. Not a lot of plot movement tonight, but I did enjoy the character interactions that we got to, you know, we got to get to know Evelyn and Cooper a little more. I kind of like the nerdy Anthony guy from the last chapter, but maybe he'll play more into it later. Kind of reminded me of Pablo a bit from Ash vs. Evil Dead. I don't really know about the side characters at the party. I'm guessing they're going to be like Freddy and Deadite fodder. But hey, the more the merrier for a book like this, you know. Looking forward to those Deadite scenes and Freddy scenes. I like where we left things tonight. A little cliffhanger. You know, is that the only Deadite Ash is going to run into? Who knows? You know, I'll be back very soon with more chapters. And I guess we're going to find out. Really looking forward to that showdown between Ash and Freddy. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Let me know what you guys thought of tonight's chapters. Was it too much slow-moving plot? Too much talk? Or did you actually enjoy the character interactions? Let me know what you think of Evelyn and Cooper and all the rest in the book. Jill and Faith. And, of course, Ash and Freddy. And I'll see you very soon with more of this great fan book. I really am enjoying it, and I cannot wait to see how it all turns out. And don't forget, at the end of this talk here, there's going to be a picture that's distorted on the screen. If you're the first person to correctly state who is in the picture and what movie it's from, you'll win some ebooks that I'll email to you. If you've already won recently, like in the past upload or two, please give other people a chance to get it right. Once, you know, about two or three narrations have gone by, if you want to try again. If you've already won recently, you can try then. But yeah, at least after you win, wait at least two or three narrations and let other people try to win. But yeah, see if you can guess who it is, and you'll win some ebooks. So until next time, this has been your friendly neighborhood slasher librarian saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and pleasant dreams! And be sure to check out this distorted picture and see if you can guess who it is and what movie it's from.